It's been another wonderful day up here on the coast of Suffolk.
We're 2 weeks in and our wildlife dramas are really hotting up.
Will our blue tits finally spread their wings?
Will our young barn owls get the food they need to survive?
And will our spineless stickleback have the verve to bring up his brood?
Answers coming up. Welcome to Springwatch.
Yes, hello and welcome to Springwatch 2015, coming to you from the beautiful RSPB's Minsmere Reserve up here on the coast of Suffolk. And it is a wonderful evening. It's been a fantastic sunny day. And if you got up early this morning, this place was really, really special. Slightly cool, mist over the water, over the fields as well. And of course, home to some really lovely birds. Batlet, heron. Look at the reflection of that gull in the still waters, and the egret here enjoying a stickleback. Our mission here, of course, is to bring you the very best of British wildlife, and to do that we've got nearly 30 cameras set out across the reserve, sticking their noses into the business of a great range of species.
And we're here at Minsmere, and it's centred around a large wetland, but what makes this place so important is that it has a variety of habitats surrounding it. One of the important ones is just behind us here. It's the reedbed habitat, and there are all sorts of iconic birds in that habitat. We've got our cameras on some of them. So let's have a look live at, well, one of our favourites. It's the bearded tit. Now let's see what's going on. This is the reed beds where the nest is, and if we go into the reeds we can see the nest. It's the female on the nest there. These are really special birds, and people come from all over the place to get just a glimpse of them. There are only 630 pairs in the UK, and we're so lucky because here at Minsmere there are 15 pairs. We've got chicks just underneath that female. Very difficult to see right now, but they are there, and they're obviously developing day by day. It's a shame we're not seeing the male in that shot, isn't it? Because it's the male that's the real iconic looking
bird. Stonker of a bird.
And it's obviously the male that gives them the name bearded tits. Although, you know, they have these little black bits that come down here. It should have been called a moustache tit. They've just got
they
it wrong.
They are more of a moustache than a
they
beard.
Really
no
are,
doubt about
aren't
that.
They
really are, aren't they?
Let's have a look at a very different nest. Now, this is in a nest box in the trees, and it's our blue tits. 10 chicks in there. I was going to say little chicks, but oh my word, have they grown. We've been watching them since the series started 2 weeks ago, and these little chicks are ready to fly. They're in the departure lounge, they've got their visas, they've packed their bags, and they are ready to fly.
Look at them preening
the
themselves,
nest.
Just getting ready to get out.
Seen
there.
Them do a lot of stretching, haven't we? We had a bet, didn't we? I bet that they're going tomorrow at 2 o'clock.
I said 8:55 tonight. They're going to go.
I'm going tomorrow morning, I think at 8.
But you know what? They could
go
tonight. They could go in the next hour, and if they do, we'll certainly cut to that live.
Now, down in the fen, we've got our shoveler's nest. Let's go down to that live, the shoveler duck. Here she is.
Oh,
that's not a shoveler.
We've got a rabbit.
Excellent. Excellent knowledge there.
That
is a shoveler. Here she is, sitting there. Just sitting there. She's been there for hours and hours. They're just sitting there. She's 23 hours a day, she just sits there. Okay, now, we've been recording what's been going on down at that nest. It's very curious. Okay, because the male shoveler, oh, here's the female, here she, we recorded this a bit earlier. She sits there on the nest, but she's alert. Even though she sits there, and if the gosling comes too close, he gets it in the face. She's very hot and she's doing gula fluttering. She's drawing air over her bill to cool herself down. Now, this is fascinating. Here's the male shoveler. Now, all the books say the male has no part whatsoever once the eggs have been laid, but we've noticed something curious. The male is going in for hostile pumping. He's seeing off any other males that come into the area near the nest. And here's another thing. When the female leaves the nest, she goes straight up vertically when she leaves. She doesn't want to leave a scent trail for a predator. She goes down to just cool down there a bit. And when she goes away, look at this. The male is there accompanying her. Now, that isn't supposed to happen at all, but because we've got the cameras there, what do you think is going on, Chris?
It's slightly odd, isn't it, really? Because mate guarding in birds is very common. The male will stick with the female whilst she's laying the eggs, and he needs to fertilise the eggs. Obviously, by doing that, he can keep other males out and ensure that he's passing his genes on. But this pair have had eggs for the best part of a month. Mm. You know, they must be on the brink of hatching. So on that account, you know, why is the male still with them? Several species of duck do this, in fact, but why they're hanging on at this time, goodness knows. And of course, they don't want to stick too close to the female because she's very well camouflaged, sat there for hours a day, hiding in the grass. He is brightly coloured, so he doesn't want to be close to her, and that's why he joins her only when she leaves the nest. So that's about avoiding predation, but I don't know about the other thing.
Fascinating. We're being disingenuous. Something amazing has actually happened in the last few hours down at the nest. We've recorded this. Now, it's quite hard to see, but we didn't know when those eggs had been laid, so when the chicks were going to hatch out. But I don't know if you can see there, there are little tiny ducklings just there. The mum's not on the nest. We've counted four initially. Not sure how many eggs there are in total, but they are hatching. Here comes proud mum. She's going to go back and brood them, looking a bit confused, thinking, blimey, what are all these things? So they are literally in the process of hatching out as we're speaking now. Now, you can monitor that hatching 24 hours a day if you want to, and the blue tips as well. Go on our website or on Red Button, and you might see what's going on before we do, but it's happening now.
Top work. Now, we've moved one of our cameras that was set up behind us down here on the Isle of Mere, that body of water you can see, over to a piece of acid grassland. There are 330 hectares of acid grassland here. It's quite an important habitat. Let's go live to that camera now and see what we can see. Well, there we've got a very important animal. It's the rabbit. Now, you may not think they're a very important animal, but without them, there wouldn't be that open grassland. Together with the deer here, their grazing stops any bushes from developing, any trees that would otherwise shade out this habitat. Now, we've been watching throughout the course of the day. Rabbits very much a part of this environment. Lots of activity, but of course, by keeping it open, they also sculpt it for birds like stone curlews and a range of other species, and not just birds, but plants and other animals too. These rabbits have obviously got sight of something. Look, they're sat up, ears attentive, and as you might imagine, it's a fox.
She's licking her lips, Chris.
She's hunting. Look, nose down, one ear back, one forward, listening in both directions at the same time. There she is, trotting off. And of course, at this time of year, there are lots of young rabbits about, inexperienced youngsters, and that's what she's going to be after. Much easier to catch. And here, she's scored, of course. And the reason she's so keen to go out and pick up a rabbit burger is this. She's got her own cubs to look after. She's trotting along there on her velvet paws.
Oh!
Well, they are, no, honestly, if you stroke a fox's foot, they feel like a little bit of velvet. They tread very softly. And down she goes into the den. And no doubt these cubs will be sharing it. And one of them's come out and it's going through typical submissive behaviour. Look, ears down, rolling down, greeting her by licking her mouth, nuzzling her. The poodles do that to me every time I get home. Well, many people's dogs do.
They do.
Yeah. And of course, they'll be there sharing that rabbit. So success for the foxes, bad luck for the rabbits on this occasion, but of course, that's the way the world goes around here.
It is. Now, a lot of life around here right now is about breeding and feeding. And I'm going off now to explore the feeding habits of one of our most spectacular aerial birds. And I'm going to do that with the aid of an enormous balloon.
Sounds interesting, Martin. Let's catch up with Iolo Williams. Now, he headed north. He went all the way to John O'Groats last week, and he travelled from there to Orkney, and now he's in Shetland. Quite a journey, really. But let me tell you, that is nothing in comparison to the bird that he's gone there to look for.
On the same latitude as Greenland and closer to the Norwegian coast than to Minsmere, Shetland feels very different to the rest of the British Isles. Its rugged landscapes and coasts are a haven for wildlife. Shetland is one of the best birdwatching locations in Europe, with millions of birds flocking here for the summer breeding season. But there's one bird I'm desperate to see on the islands.
Now, the red-necked phalarope is an incredibly rare bird. I'm on the ferry on the way to Fetla, right up in the north of Shetland. And Fetla is the best place in the whole of the UK to see the red-necked phalarope. But I'm still talking about just a handful of birds. That's how rare it is. It's a big island, so I'm going to need some help.
I'm hoping Malky Smith from the RSPB will help me find them.
Red-necked phalarope now, Malky, is such a scarce bird, so difficult to see. Why is that?
Well, globally it's not that rare a bird, but within the UK it's a rare bird.
It's right on the edge of its range.
We're at the southern edge of its range.
How many breeding pairs, if I can use that term, would you expect to get on here?
It varies quite a lot. In the last couple of years, numbers have been really good, so maybe 20, 25 or so males.
So are we likely to see some today? After all, I've got a man who lives and breathes phalaropes with me.
If we're very careful and very lucky, we might see one or two.
Brilliant, Malky. I'm in your hands, mate.
Phalaropes are seabirds and spend most of their time out at sea, where they have predominantly grey and white plumage. But during the breeding season, they return to land, molting into their distinctive red necks and behaving more like wading birds.
They'll tend to be within these sedge beds.
Oh, just in front of you there. Just in front of you there. Can you see them? Two of them in the vegetation. You see that?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah? Oh, wow. I tell you what, they're much smaller than I expected them to be.
Oh, they're tiny, significantly smaller than a starling.
Yes.
You know, they're not much bigger than a house sparrow.
Well, go on.
Tiny.
You lead on, I'll follow you. I've got this horrible feeling we're going to end up to our necks any minute now.
I think there's a pair of birds just come in here.
Oh, just on the edge of the water there, is it?
Yeah.
Sneak in slowly. Oh, yeah. Wow, that's the female I can see
that's
well
a
now, is it?
Female on our left.
I see.
Male on the right.
Gosh, she's a little beaut, isn't she?
Yeah.
Lovely bird. They're weird birds, aren't they? Because they've got this reverse sexual dimorphism. I mean, everything you'd expect of a male bird, virtually, she does.
The females are significantly bigger, more brightly coloured, bolder, more aggressive. The males do all the incubating and all the rearing of the chicks.
So she's got it easy.
She's got a pretty easy life.
The females do all the displaying too. Many can vie for a male's attention, which can be a little overwhelming. With little to do but lay the eggs, the females have many clutches throughout the season, while the males do all the work. But Malky has something even more incredible to reveal about these unique little birds. He fitted some with tiny geolocator tracking devices and followed their annual migration.
We wanted to test the hypothesis that our birds join the Scandinavian phalarope population and winter in the Arabian Sea. Now, one did come back, and we managed to retrieve his tag, and the results were astonishing. Rather than head south, as you'd expect our birds to go, he headed west and ended up in the Pacific.
This remarkable little bird travelled halfway across the world.
He headed across the Atlantic, down the eastern seaboard of the States and Canada, into the Caribbean, crossed into the Pacific, where he joined the North American phalarope population, and he spent the winter bobbing about in the waters of Galapagos.
That's phenomenal for such a small bird as well.
Yeah.
Not only are they stunning birds, but they're fantastic travellers as well.
Yep.
Amazing.
Malky takes me to the very bird that made that epic transatlantic journey.
Oh, here's the male. Look at that.
It's a male just off to the left.
Yeah.
And he seems to have attracted the attention of a female.
Look at that. Little beauties, look at that. Amazing little birds.
Amazing little birds indeed.
They really are, and I had no idea they were so small, Chris.
They're tiny, they're about that big. They're tiny, but the distance as they travel, let's just reprise that with this globe that I've got here. So here you've got a bird that's going from Scotland, it's flying over, going all the way down the eastern seaboard of America, crossing over the Gulf of Mexico and the Isthmus there, and then going out to the Galapagos Isles, and then, of course, it's going back again. And that's a distance of around 16,000 miles. And you know, one of these birds was found to have lived more than 12 years. So if we calculate the distance that it flew in its lifetime, that's more than 208,000 miles, 334,000 kilometres, which is more than 8 times around the diameter of our planet. What a bird. And do you know what? Last week there were a couple of redneck phalaropes here at Minsmere. A male and a female turned up. And we think that this is because they overshot Scotland. So they're on their way back across the top of the planet here. But the northerly winds that we had pushed them down this side of the country and they ended up down at Minsmere. It just so happens that Adam Rowlands, the reserve warden here, he studied these birds for some time and he thinks that now they've left and they probably headed back north trying to find a mate and get into breeding as quickly as possible.
Such an impressive little bird. It must have so many air miles, mustn't it?
It must have a tremendous number of air miles, yeah.
Well, from a very small, rare bird, one that's much more familiar to us. And in fact, this bird has the widest range of any bird in the world. You can find it on every continent except Antarctica. It is the barn owl. We've got cameras on a family of barn owls and you know that, well, there's the exterior of their nest. This is live, and if we go in to have a look at them, we can see the three chicks there. Now we know that this site has been used for 2 years now, and we know that the chicks are about 5 weeks old. They're expected to fledge in early July. They've had it, it's actually quite difficult to see the three in there. It just looks like one big fluffy one, doesn't it, Chris? But
it
there
does.
Are definitely
it's
three.
Looking at something. That's what it's doing. That's why it's rotating its head like that.
Oh, look.
It's getting perspective. In fact, look, it's looking at the insect.
It is.
It's following that insect that's flying around.
Must be pretty dark in there, mustn't it? A little bit of light maybe seeping in.
But do you know something interesting? If they don't focus on the things at this time in their life, their eyesight doesn't develop properly and they later can't effectively hunt. So at this stage, what that owl is doing is intrinsically important as to how it's going to live for the rest of its life.
Well, obviously, though, do you think that's the largest one? It looks like it could be, doesn't it? Or it could be the medium-sized one.
It's probably medium, that one, to be honest with you.
But they've been having a bit of a tough time over the last couple of nights because the weather has not been great and that makes it very difficult for barn owls to hunt. However, last night was a different story. Beautiful light, barn owls are out early hunting. Let's just watch this barn owl hunt. It has acute hearing, so it listens out for its prey. And it's got offset ears to pinpoint the sound. You can see it's heard something. Folds its wings, down it goes. It almost looks like it's going to headbutt the ground, but it turns it around, it gets it in its feet. This one then has passed it to its beak. And look, then the pass goes back to the feet. And as I say, last night was a much better night for hunting their prey. So let's have a look at the chicks, how they've got on over the last 24 hours. As I say, a couple of nights ago, they only got two feeds, which simply isn't enough when you've got three chicks. And the three chicks here, you can see the smallest one is in the middle. And if you look at their facial discs, very different. Here comes the adult with some prey. And this is what we were really chuffed to see, because that's the smallest chick, the runty chick, and it's come to the front and it's taken that prey from the adult. And what's interesting is the other two are just letting the little one eat it, which probably means that they've already had a feed. It's also interesting to see that it's not swallowing that prey whole, it's sort of picking at it. Maybe it's a fussy eater, but it's having a little pick, which does get me a bit worried, Chris, because that means it's going to be quite rancid in there. It looks like there's quite a lot of sort of bits of
often
prey.
They store food in the nest. If they catch a surplus number of mammals, you'll find them. I remember climbing up to Barnard's Nest, you find a vole lying there, a rat. They will eat it before it rots away, unless there's a super surplus of food. But the key thing there is that the other two are not harassing that, which means they've certainly eaten their fill. And this is good news. It's suggesting that all three of them might, at this stage, fledge successfully.
Do you think that little one's going to be all right, then?
At the moment, I'm banking on the little one.
Although, they have predicted thunderstorms on Friday night, so that is not going to be great.
But they're quite big, so one night off, again, shouldn't be too bad. I'll tell you what, it's nice down here in the shive light, isn't it?
The shive light?
The shive light. Look, there's a shaft of shive light over there. See that shaft of shive light? That's today's spring word, shive light. A sliver or splinter of light breaking through a forest.
I like that word. It's a nice word.
Shive light. Very, very good indeed. How's Martin getting on, and what on earth does he need a large balloon for?
We'll come to that in just a second, Chris. Now, for me, one of the most exciting live cameras we've got is the one that's filming swifts. Let's go live to our swift cam in Bristol. Now, there's the outside of the building where it is, and that's the inside. Now, bear in mind, that animal, that swift, may not have touched the ground for 2 years before it came in to nest there. It did everything up in the air. They live for a long time, swifts. This one could be as much as 20 years old. And they used to be known, their Latin name is Apus apus, which means no legs, no legs. People used to literally think that swifts didn't have any legs. Okay. That's a swift, but how do you tell the difference between swifts, swallows, and martins? Because they all look sort of basically a similar sort of shape. So let's just go here. These are the swifts. They're actually brown, but they look all black, and they've got those sickle-shaped wings there. This is a martin here. This is a house martin. They've got this white backside there and white underneath and a bluish sheen. And down here is a sand martin. Don't see them so often unless you're near the sea. They're brown with a white spot. And this is the one that's quite familiar to us all, the swallow, the forked tail, and that lovely rufous bit round the throat. Okay, that's what they look like if you get close enough up to them. But what about when they're flying around? Well, you can get a good clue from the way they fly. Now, look at this area here, all of this. What would you expect to see flying around here? You'd expect to see swallows. And they clip along the ground, low to the ground, looking for insects that are just jumping up in the air. Often they'll look for insects that have been disturbed by animals, so they'll follow dogs, they'll follow cattle to pick up the insects, grasshoppers and things that are jumping up into the air. So that's a swallow. Now this here is a sand martin. Now you can see they will nest in the dunes and so on. They're brown, they've got that white underneath. Very obvious, much less seen, much less regularly seen. And here is, you may have these if you're very lucky on your house, they're house martins. Please, if you've got these fabulous nests, don't knock them down. I know they poo on the car a bit, but what a privilege to have them there. And then finally, we come to the swifts. Now, this time of the evening, swifts tend to come down a bit. You may hear them screaming around the rooftops near you, but most of the day they're up high, way high up in the sky. Way up. Sometimes they're really hard to see. But the question is this, what are those swifts doing when they're way, way up in the sky, 100 metres or more up? Well, we're going to do some serious science now, and we're lucky enough we've got Dr. Jason Chapman and Phil here from Rothamsted Research. I got it right, didn't I?
That's right.
Okay, and we've got with us the kytoon. And it's called the kytoon because it's half a kite and half a balloon. And if you've ever tried to fly a kite when there's no wind, you'll know we've got a bit of a problem. But never mind. This is the principle. The kytoon goes up into the sky, and attached underneath is this net here. And right at the back of the net, can we see the end of the net there? That's the end of the net. All the little insects, anything that's up there, will be swept into the net there. Now we're going to try, we'll have a go at chucking it up into the sky and see if we can actually catch anything now. And when you come back, we'll see what the kitoon has managed to grab. Now, I often see the first swift or swallow of the year up on the Mendip Hills in Somerset. And on those hills, there are lots of tiny little ponds, and early in spring, they're a hive of activity.
Early April in North Somerset. This secluded spot makes an unlikely location for a springtime rendezvous. The reservoir for an ancient lead mine. Centuries of exploitation spoiled the land. But in the 100 years since the pits were abandoned, this poisoned place has been taken over by toads. Every spring, after a few nights topping 6 degrees, they arrive, trudging in from up to a mile away. An eager male has caught a lift, stealing a march on his rivals. Clasping her in a tight embrace, he bestows an unlikely advantage on his mate. He's her onboard bodyguard. The determined couples search for somewhere safe to deposit their eggs. Deep water offers them protection from the pool's hungry residents. Another female arrives, alone. For her, the road to reproduction won't be so smooth. Without a partner to defend her, she attracts plenty of attention. Hormones, pheromones, and the sight of a plump paramour drive the males wild with desire. They pile in, desperate to procreate. Soon the helpless female is smothered in suitors. But she won't spawn until a single victor emerges. In the frenzy, the males do their best to palm off the competition. But they keep on coming, squeezing the female in a deadly embrace. At the heart of the melee, there's little she can do. The consequences can be fatal. Suffocated and crushed, many females meet a watery end. 80% of males are left without a mate. As the battle wears on, weaker males loosen their grip. The female makes a break for it. She heads for a quiet corner away from the rough and tumble, with her strongest suitor protecting her. Finally, she releases a string of jelly-coated spawn. Up to 5,000 eggs take a few hours to produce. Within days, the pool is festooned with hundreds of thousands of eggs. There may have been casualties, but there are plenty of replacements on the way. Within weeks, they'll develop and depart. And the old lead mine will be abandoned once more.
Well, it was an amazing film, but it has made me think of Wind in the Willows and Mr. Toad. Do you remember him? I mean, he was quite a cad, wasn't he? And he had this big Toad of Toad Hall mansion and an obsession with driving cars. This made me realise that, you know, there's a lot of competition to get a female toad. Although I've got to admit, I don't like the thought of Mr. Toad in a mating frenzy. It's a bit unsavoury, really, isn't it? Did you read them?
I've never read it.
So you've no idea what I'm talking about.
I'm afraid I haven't, no. I never read it. I was watching Tales of the Riverbank on Watch With Mother. Watch With Mother.
Don't remember that.
Oh, get off. You remember that. Yeah, Hammy the Hamster in the Boat. Do you remember that? Whenever I used to walk along the river, I'd be looking for Hammy the Hamster. I never saw Hammy the Hamster, but occasionally my sister's wheelchair...
Pushchair.
It would crunch the gravel, and I'd hear a little popping sound. And the popping sound was a water vole jumping into the river. But of course, these days, you hardly ever see these. But we've been very lucky here at Minsmere to be watching water voles. We've got a camera set up. Now, these are herbivorous rodents. They eat a mixture of sedges, rushes. In the autumn time, they'd eat fruits as well. Here's one nibbling some grass. About 227 different species have been recorded in their diet, species of plant, and they have to eat 80% of their own body weight a day. So we thought we'd set up a little feeding trial.
We thought we'd try the water vole with different foods. Have a look at this. This is what we put out for the water vole. Some watercress, some blackberries, and a lovely yummy bit of trout. Which one will it go for? Well, it comes in, I've got to say, that doesn't look very interesting to eat, that droopy watercress. It goes straight for the blackberries, which is what we'd expect. They're full of sugar. And you can see this water vole is really making the most of them. If you keep watching, I think, oh, this is nighttime, and the white is the blackberry. But I think perhaps this water vole has had a few too many, because watch what happens. Gets to the jar and it pulls it into the water. A bit of a disaster, really, for the water vole. But interesting, because they will cache blackberries.
It was taking them off to cache them somewhere.
I think it probably was.
But it blew it.
Comes back very quickly and takes the one remaining blackberry.
Yeah.
But what's interesting, if you keep watching, is that it comes back and takes a bit of the fish. Now, this came as a bit of a surprise to us, because we were expecting it to come back and keep going at the blackberries, but no, it's come back for that fish.
That's a bit of a nibble at the fish.
It does. Surprising?
Yeah. There was a guy called Robert Randall in 2010 who was looking at water voles in Wiltshire, and he found that they were nibbling the legs of frogs, the female water voles, possibly because they were suffering a protein deficiency when they were carrying their young. But then we've also had this sent in from one of our viewers. Ian Green sent us this picture of a water vole nibbling a stickleback.
Oh no!
But we don't think it's catching them. These are not predators, they're scavengers. And if there is a source of protein there, it's probably going to be far more desirable to eat that than it is to munch your way through masses of cellulose, plant material, which is difficult to digest because the protein will be more accessible. And of course, it went for the fruit because that's packed full of sugar, it's soft, not much chewing required, instant return for your effort of munching it.
Should we have a look and see if they're there live? Sadly, they're not at the moment, but we have been getting great views of these water voles, haven't we?
Yeah, we have, but we'd like you to report any views that you get of water voles too. The Canals and Rivers Trust have launched an app, a really good one, really works really well. You can get details about that on our website, and if you do see any voles, then please fill in the information and send it off. The more we get to learn about these animals, creatures that have declined by 97% in recent times, the better able we will be able to conserve them.
Well, from a cute aquatic rodent to what is now the largest rodent we have in the UK, the beaver. And over the last couple of days, Martin has been following the return of the beaver into English waters after an official absence of 400 years. Well, today he's looking at what effect those beavers will have on the environment.
Beavers were once native to Britain, but their return now is controversial, because of their ability to dramatically alter the landscape by building dams and lodges. Because they've been absent from England for so long, no one knows what their return will involve or how much effect they will have on the landscape in and around our river systems. So in 2011, the Devon Beaver Project was set up to assess their impact.
Everywhere you look, there are...
Mark Elliott is the project manager, and he showed me round.
So, Mark, what was it like before the beavers came?
Well, it was an awful lot drier. There was just this little tiny stream running through the site. You can just about make out the old channel there.
Well, this is the actual channel here?
Yeah, that was it. But there was no other standing water on the site at all. So all of the open water that we see here now is all generated by the beavers. Like this.
That's a bit of a transformation, isn't it?
There's about 250 square metres of water in some of these biggest ponds. I mean, you can see the level of the dam now. It's about a metre and a half, 2 metres high.
How many beavers does it take to do this? I mean, dozens.
So we've only got four in here at the moment.
Four beavers did this?
Yeah.
It's all infilled with mud, presumably.
It's almost the mud that they start off with, and then they add additional sticks for support. So they're dredging the mud from the pond. You see them surging forward,
right?
Push this mud up onto the top of the dam, and then they'll add sticks to that. I mean, it's remarkable, really. We've got now about 600 cubic metres of water standing in these ponds on the site.
So once they got their teeth in, there was no stopping them?
No, that's right. They really went for it.
One potential benefit of the creation of these pools is that heavy rainfall is retained and released slowly, helping to reduce flooding further downstream.
We're seeing all sorts of impacts here. They're not called a keystone species for nothing. Come and have a look at this.
Ooh, tantalising.
Some of the changes were expected, but one in particular was dramatic and surprising.
So one of the things that's done really well is common frogs. And this is a huge area of frog spawn here, look.
Oh, look at that, they've all hatched out.
They're all just hatched.
Wow.
So there's thousands and thousands of them here.
When you get your eye in, they're everywhere, aren't they?
This is all one big area of them. I mean, we counted 521 clumps across the site this year, and that compares to only 10 in the first year. When we put the beavers in, yeah. So, I mean, there was nowhere for them to breed. There was just no standing water at all. So since the beavers have come, they've created all of these amazing ponds, and the frogs are just absolutely loving it. So numbers have just come up and up and up.
And I suppose tadpoles, frogs, bottom of the food chain, other wildlife will be benefiting from this.
Yeah, I mean, absolutely. Things like herons, we're seeing a lot of herons here now because they're feeding on the frogs. Grass snakes, you know, you'd expect to see an increase in grass snakes because, again, they're feeding on the frogs. They're just a really important part of the food chain.
It seems to me, though, that everything seems to be positive. Everything seems to be benefiting from what the beavers are doing. I mean, are there any downsides?
Well, I mean, I think, you know, there's always going to be a mixed picture. There's going to be some things that benefit and some things that don't do quite so well. One of the concerns that's raised by salmon fishermen particularly is about fish migration. They struggle to get up over the dams into the headwaters where they breed. And that's what does happen in some cases. If you've got a series of dams in the way as the salmon migrate upstream to their spawning gravels, then those dams prevent access to the upper tributaries. But those impacts will vary a lot between catchment to catchment.
Although not everyone welcomes the return of these keystone engineers, they're now living wild on the River Otter, at least for a trial period. But it will take several years of monitoring before the full impact of their return to English waterways is fully understood.
It's amazing to see the positive effect they've had on frogs, isn't it?
Yeah, not just That's frogs, brilliant. Amphibians, fish, insects, reptiles, all the way through the food chain.
Well, the update on them is that the two females should have given birth by now. There's been no positive sign of the kits. But then again, after birth, they will stay underground for maybe a month or so. So, all good news.
Fingers crossed. Mm-hmm. But from one animal that's been absent from our landscape for 400 years to another that's been absent for 700 years, but is now very definitely back, one of our cameramen went down to the forest of Dean, where we found a sounder of these. A sounder is the collective name for wild boar, and in the bluebell woods of the Forest of Dean, there are at the moment a few of these animals. And look at that, there they are, rooting away, using their noses to root out the tubers of the bluebells. And look at this. Here's a group of their young. They call them humbugs because of their stripes and spots, which they have when they're even younger. And already they've learned how to use their noses to get out those bluebell tubers. Now, you may think, if you're a fan of these flowers, and we all are, that this is hugely destructive. And of course, in the short term, a patch like this will be missing a few flowers. But scientists have discovered that after a couple of years, the bluebells come back with a far greater density and a far greater vigour than if the boar weren't there. And you can see that youngster enjoying the bluebells. And if you count carefully, you'll see that there are 17 young boar jumping across this stream. So that's not a single litter. What happens is that the sows will combine them, kind of crash them into larger groups. So social group size in Bor can go from 6 to 60, depending on the number of youngsters. There they are, nuzzling down. Super pictures, look at that. Their little tails stuck up.
I think it is absolutely lovely to see those little humbugs in the shive light.
Oh,
got your word in, and that's a perfect way to use it as well.
It was indeed. Great film.
I've got a map here showing the distribution, or the sightings, should I say, of wild boar. Now, this is the Forest of Dean. This is the largest population that we've got in the country. They reckon there's just over 800 animals there. And then there's another large population. You can see lots of sightings down here in Kent and East Sussex. A couple of hundred wild boar there, although they are a bit concerned about those ones because they're very isolated, which could mean there's a genetic problem going there, not enough genetic diversity. And you can see there are various other sightings around the country, including some up here in Scotland. Although we're not really sure whether they're definite sightings, they haven't been verified, and they may not be viable populations. But how have they all got there? Well, they're either escapees from boar farms or even from abattoirs, or possibly they've been accidentally released.
Accidentally released. Now, there's no doubt in the past that these animals played a very valuable role in our ecosystem. We've got to be fair and say that some people believe they don't play a very good role in our ecosystem now, that they damage crops, they damage vineyards, people's property, and they could even be a danger to us and our dogs. All sorts of opinions about these sorts of animals. Of course, they were a native species, and we hold even stronger opinions about non-native species. So do join us for Unsprung after this programme, on the red button and online, where a man called Fred Pierce has written a pretty controversial book on the benefits of non-native species. Hands up for grey squirrel. Oh, come on.
Oh.
Hands up for American mink. Hands up for American mink. Yeah, it's a tough one. It's going to be a very interesting programme. Do join us for that.
Well, from boars to Martin. Not that there's any connection whatsoever.
That's a lovely throw, Michaela. Thank you very much indeed. Now, let's just reset our mission. We're trying to find out what swifts, high-flying swifts, feed on right up in the sky with the help of Rothamsted Research and this amazing kytoon. Now, how does the kytoon work? Well, we've tried to get it up, but the wind has dropped completely, and it's kind of like a kite, so it needs some wind. But earlier today, we did manage to get it up. Here it is. And look, you can see underneath the kytoon is the net that actually captures the insects that are flying there. And luckily, Jason's been able to capture some of these insects for us, and we got some actually here in the sort of jar. Have a look at it. They've been a little bit sort of recalcitrant, haven't they? They're all sort of cooling down a bit.
That's right.
Well, what have we got there, do you think, Jason?
Well, the most common insects in here are aphids or greenfly. They're very abundant at high altitudes. Right. We've also got the parasitic wasps that attack them. Okay. And a wide range of small beetles and small flies.
Now, it may look like this isn't much of a meal for a swift flying around, but what they do is they catch lots and lots of them, and they form a bolus, what's called a bolus, and they'll carry that around with them. And an average bolus will have 300 to 500 of these tiny insects, and that is much more of a meal. But because Jason was able to catch these, we put them under the microscope and we filmed them so we can see closer what they are. There are the aphids that you talked about. You say most of the animals you see are aphids up there.
Yeah, they're certainly the most common group of insects.
Got a wasp too.
Parasitic wasp that attacks the aphids.
Right, so there's a bit of a community. Beetles are up there as well.
Yeah, beetles are in very large numbers.
And this is a predatory beetle up there too. Strange-looking thing.
Yes.
And lots of small flies.
That's right.
And spiders. Spiders. Now, that's a little bit curious. How on earth would a spider get sort of 100 metres up into the sky? Well, it's absolutely fascinating how they do it. Look at this. See this spider? And you can see it jetting silk out of its abdomen. And it lets out more and more of a trail of silk up into the wind. And once that silk line is long enough, the wind whips it away and carries it up higher and higher into the sky. It's called ballooning. So that is how the spiders get up there. But Jason, it fascinates me. I mean, all those little things there, are they just drifting around aimlessly? What are they doing up there?
No, they're not drifting aimlessly at all. So they've all got specialised behaviours. We saw the spiders there, they use this ballooning silk, and the insects actually fly upwards to get up into these faster moving air currents. They want to move a long distance, so they're actually trying to find new habitats.
So they're sort of migrating, they're dispersing, in fact.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah. And so we see that they can travel for tens of kilometres in a single flight. And what they're doing is they want to leave a patch of habitat which is deteriorating and find somewhere which is better, maybe more food or less predators.
That's amazing. There's a whole community up there. I mean, have you got any idea? Can you calculate what the mass is? I mean, how many of them are up there?
Well, we have actually done that. And so if you imagine a 1 kilometre square window of the atmosphere, what we've done is measure the numbers of individuals of insects that would flow through that during a typical summer's month. And it was actually a staggering 3.5 billion individual insects.
Billion insects.
Yes.
And what sort of weight of sort of biomass would that be?
Well, that's about a ton of insects, or 20 sheep, for example.
20 sheep?
Yes.
That's absolutely fascinating. So if you lie down in your garden in summer and look up, it looks completely empty, but there's 20 sheep. Now, there's an enormous amount of insects flying up there. So that is the reason. That is what the swifts are doing up there. Thank you very much indeed. Amazing bit of science.
Thank you.
With a chitoon. I want one. Now, when the swifts arrive, we can see them all over the country, really. You probably see them over your town and hear them screaming. But there's another very delicate, very beautiful bird that is only found on a number of tiny islands in the Irish Sea.
Four miles off the Irish coast, Rockabill Island is home to a wealth of bird life. Seabirds flock in from their wintering grounds. Kittiwakes, black guillemots, and common terns all nest here. But the island is also where roseate terns choose to nest. They have black bills and are slightly smaller in stature than common terns. In spring, adults return here in fresh breeding plumage with the flushed pink breasts that give them their name. There are less than 2,500 pairs of these rare birds in the whole of Europe, so they need a little help. Nest boxes are put out. Roseate pairs breed together for many years, and some are faithful to each other for their entire lives. After spending the winter apart, established pairs often return to exactly the same nest box. But before they breed, they need to reacquaint themselves with one another. Single birds preen themselves on the rocks. You've got to look your best if you want to attract a mate. Males bring in fish to woo the females. Head raised, tail raised, the courtship dance begins. Males circle the females. But competition is fierce and fights are inevitable. Thank you. the first eggs will be laid, and the more serious business of raising a family will begin.
What a bird.
Gorgeous bird.
I think they've leapt into my charts. I'd forgotten how good roseate terns are. The angles of those wings, the tail cocked up.
I like the little pink bit.
Really good, really good.
Anyway, the star of last year's series was the bittern, a fabulous looking bird. The star of this series has been a stickleback, and interestingly enough, last year's star would eat this year's star, along with water voles, egrets, otters, and loads of other things. In fact, it's amazing that the sticklebacks are still alive so far. But we've been featuring two different ones. Now, these sticklebacks are little fish, and we've got names for them. One's called Spineless Cy, and one's called Frisky Phil. So called because he got a mate very quickly. And yesterday we saw him fanning his eggs that he's laid in the nest, that it is in the water down by the reed beds, and looking really good. How's he looking today, though? Let's have a look. Well, surprisingly, he's not looking as good. He seems to have lost condition. He's not as red. You can see he's looking very dull. This is at night. He's not getting much sleep. They generally don't when they're brooding. He's not eating. And look, if you look, he's got parasites on him. Now, they also might be sapping his energy, but he's definitely lost condition.
He's a sorry-looking stickleback.
I think he's spent, Chris. He's spent.
He's
spent so much energy mating. Look at what happens here. He can't even fight off a water beetle. What has happened to him?
Frisky Phil. Frisky Phil has lost his frisk. He's friskless. He's friskless Phil. His rival, Spineless Cy. Now, Spineless Cy, when we left him yesterday, simply wasn't fanning enough. Now, the fanning is all about aerating the eggs, pushing oxygenated water through the nest to make sure there's plenty of oxygen for those developing eggs. It's absolutely essential that they do this. And we think they could have hundreds of eggs in there. If they don't do it, the eggs will die. Cy wasn't doing it, but how's he been getting on since then? Well, frankly, folks, he's turned a corner. Look at him. He's still pumped up. He's like a little ruby down there, laying down his spigot on the silt. He's patrolling the nest constantly. And he's got to do that because other sticklebacks, particularly females, will come in like this one. Look at this one. She's coming in and she's thinking, I need some protein to produce my eggs. I'm going to nick Cy's. But no, Cy is chasing that female off. He's being very dutiful, like a little torpedo. This female too thinks, I'm going to have a nibble. And he shows her what's what.
Get out of it, he's saying, isn't he?
And then this one actually gets as far as the nest. She's eating the eggs and Cy gets her by the tail and drags her off. It's worth seeing again. Oh, Cy, he's turned a corner. Look at him. Here she is. No, we don't want any cannibalism, thank you, missus. You're out. And out he goes.
Superstar stud Cy. We've got to change his name.
And now it swings to Phil, and it's swinging back to Cy. But they have got a problem, and it's the sunshine. You see, it's been really, really warm here today. We tested the water temperature, 20.8 degrees C. The trouble with warm water is that the amount of oxygen in it goes down and down, as you can see. So if the sun comes up and the water warms up, it might develop the eggs more quickly, but they're going to be starved of oxygen.
They're going to have to fan, aren't they?
So if we continue to have really hot weather, they're going to have to be fanning like mad. Phil's already given up the fanning. Cy's got to stick with it. And I'll tell you one other thing, Michaela.
Yeah.
Last year, down on the boardwalk there, by this time, it had dried up.
Oh, no. Don't say
the
that.
The great British weather could have a hold over the future of these two fabulous little fish. We need to know what the weather's going to do. Who better to ask than Nick Miller at the BBC Weather Centre?
Well, Chris, I may be about to raise the stakes, but first of all, don't worry, no one's frying tonight. It's warm, but it's not getting hot, and the warm air coming to Minsmere tomorrow has more cloud with it. There'll be showers, but maybe a thunderstorm. Has Spineless Simon factored a lightning strike into his grand plan? Well, that's a very slim possibility, but best not stick his rear end above the surface in the next 24 hours. There could be a torrential downpour, though, and that quick rush of water wouldn't be good, nor for ground nesting birds. birds, so keep a close eye on the Springwatch webcams tomorrow. Not everywhere is warm, though. North and west of the UK, we're just close to normal. Bit of rain around tomorrow. That pushes on through for the weekend. If you're close to this area of low pressure, it's quite windy initially with a few showers. Conditions will improve, and actually there is a lot of fine weather around across the UK to get out and enjoy the wildlife near you this weekend. At Minsmere, it's cracking. Notice the temperatures have come down. If the blue tits wait until the weekend to fledge, they'll be doing so in better weather than the wrens. 20 degrees tomorrow. The aphids like to take off and get busy mating in temperatures like that. If they do, the swifts will be waiting. They're on the menu. Neither will appreciate thunderstorms. Good owl hunting weather this weekend. And with temperatures coming down, it's not going to get too stinky in that nest. And for Frisky Phil and Spineless Simon, a busy weekend. A new catchphrase for them to encourage them. Keep fanning.
Love it.
Well done, Nick. Thank you very much indeed. Now, as Michaela said, last year the star of our show was the bittern. It's not an easy bird to see, but you can very often hear it here. This is what it sounds like. That's the deep, booming call of the bittern. Well, we asked you if you had any baby boomers. Yes, could any of your kids replicate that? Let's see.
Hello, Chris, Martin and Michaela. This is my bittern.
Booming from Wembley Stadium, the FA Cup Final 2015. Mm-boy, mm-boy.
I'm not sure that was a bittern. It's more like a bearded tit, actually, because well, you're going to have the last laugh because Arsenal won, of course.
Yeah, he was a definite winner, wasn't he? Shall we have a quick look at our live cameras? Because I think we need to possibly say goodbye to the blue tits.
They're
still with us, but as we were saying, we were taking bets on when they would go.
I've just lost Michaela.
I said 2 o'clock tomorrow, and what did you say again, Chris?
I said about 8 o'clock tomorrow morning.
But it'll be interesting to see when they do go. And of course, you can carry on watching the live cameras over the weekend online and on the red button. And you might see them go before we tell you that they've gone when we come back on Monday. And you can carry on as well, watching all the old sticklebacks fanning away.
Fanning. Fantastic, fantastic stuff. Don't forget to join us for Unsprung. Coming up after this programme, of course, we've got Wildlife Crime Officer Mark Bryant here to talk about wildlife crime. Should be a lively discussion.
Well, 2 weeks have gone already of the series. Oh, but we've got a week to go, and this is what's coming up next week.
More wild tales from across the country.
Iolo nears journey's end on his island odyssey.
And we bring you the inside story on a remarkable new family.
Well, have a great weekend. What are you going to do this weekend?
Oh, I might do a bit of bird watching on the reserve.
I'm spying the side. I'm telling you,
I'm going to put up my moth trap, I think. See what maths. Yeah, you know, do 30 things, whatever it was. Absolutely fantastic. Well, it's been absolutely wonderful time we've had these last 2 weeks. Don't forget, we'll be back next week. And join us, if you possibly can, for what it says here, the very best of British wildlife. See you then. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
It will change everything. Crucial information comes to light next on BBC Two in the final episode of The Game.